Arya of 6 years joining. Welcome. Okay, so I think we'll get started. My name is Garima, and I work for Early Bird. Early Bird is an initiative of Nature Conservation Foundation, and we are a group that aims to get children interested in birds. And we've been doing this series of webinars. This is our 7th one. So if you missed the earlier ones, you can go on YouTube to our YouTube channel and find them. And some of them are also on Facebook, so you can look them up there. My colleagues, Misha and Abhisheka, are also online. And whatever questions you have, if any, during the course of the talk, you can type them into the chat box. And Misha and Abhisheka will answer them. We've muted everyone's mics because we are recording this session. At the moment, there's some disturbance in my background, so I'll wait for that to pass before I start the session. So do type in the chat box whatever you need to message to us, and we'll get started in a minute. So in this session, we are going to talk about a little bit about the ecology and behavior of birds. And this is part two of a session that we conducted earlier, where we had covered some aspects of this. Before I start, Misha and Abhisheka, if at any point you see any obstruction on the screen, or you need to tell me something, just unmute and let me know.
Sure.
Yeah. So during this lockdown, lots of people have been watching birds and getting interested in birds. And so I'm going to introduce you to a little bit of more about birds. But just to start with, India is home to a remarkable variety of birds. There are about 1,300 species of birds that are found in India. And the reason for that is we have a wide variety of habitats, from deserts to tropical rainforests, from the highest mountains to the middle of the ocean. There's a wide variety of habitats, and as a result of that, there's a wide variety of bird species that we have in India. Birds have also been part of our culture and our mythology, and we've all grown up hearing stories about birds. Birds are mentioned in the Bible, in the Quran, and there are legends about birds in Hindu mythology as well. Birds are also part of our culture. So the birds on the left that are shown here are sarus cranes, which have a strong cultural significance in North India. They are a symbol of love and fidelity. While the birds on the right are, this bird is a Great Indian Hornbill, one of the participants' favorite bird here. And hornbills find mention in the folk stories of the Northeast. And in fact, hornbills redefine the meaning of lockdown. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, go back and listen to part one of our lecture series, which mentions about this behavior of hornbills in some detail. We also have birds all around us, no matter which part of the country we live in. So on this slide, I've shown 10 common birds that are found across India. And it would be useful for all of us to get familiarized with at least these common birds and their calls while we are, you know, stuck indoors and unable to go out for bird watching, but we can certainly encounter these birds from our homes. So in the earlier session, we discussed several questions that may occur to us regarding what is it like to be a bird. And here are some of those questions. And the children in the audience, I'm sure you would come up with many more questions that occur to you. And you know, some of those questions, we would have to scratch our heads and we may not know the answers. But here are some questions listed. So why do birds have feathers? How come birds can fly? How well can they see or hear? Why do they sing? What do they eat? So some of these questions we addressed in our last session. I'll just do a very brief recap. So we discussed feathers and we discussed how fascinating feathers are. They are quite incredible, structures in terms of their structure as well as their function. So they fulfill a variety of functions from flight to display and in some cases camouflage. They also keep birds warm and dry. So really quite an amazing piece of engineering. So if you haven't heard our session, go back and listen to part 4 of our series where we've discussed this. Then the next question we talked about was, what do birds eat? There's a wide variety of food that birds eat as shown in the slide. And a few things about the diet and food of birds we discussed in our earlier session. So in today's session, what we are going to do is to talk about some other questions that may occur to us from the list that I showed you earlier. So one of the most important ones is how well do birds see? And actually, eyesight in birds is quite an important feature. So we'll spend a little more time on this. So you can see on the slide different birds that are found in India and you know what their eyes look like. But we are going to start with playing a game. And the way that we'll play this is, first you have to locate these buttons. So we are going to use two buttons here. One is a green yes button and the other is a red no button. So just try and find those buttons either on your mobile or on your computer screen. So you go to the participants tab and you'll see at the bottom on the mobile like this and on the screen like this, you'll see at, on the bottom these buttons for raise hand, yes, no. And I'll give you a minute to locate these. So are you all able to find the buttons? Just type in the chat box. Okay. Okay. So shall we go on? So don't use the marker. I'll have to clear all of them. So Misha and Abhisheka,
yes,
you'll have to just clear the drawings if people, you know, mark on the screen by mistake.
Oh, okay.
So under annotate, you'll find clear and clear all drawings.
Okay, I'll have to. Annotate is where?
So in the panel, in the panel that you see, where you see participants, new share, pause share, and then annotate. Yeah, so it's clear now. Yeah. Okay. So one person isn't able to find the button, Tarini. Just see what it looks like here on this slide. We've shown where you can find the buttons. So yes, no, at the bottom here, under the list of participants. Okay, so shall we move on?
Yeah, I think a lot of people have been able to figure it out.
Okay, so moving on, we are going to ask a few questions. So how do birds see the world? And you have to click on either yes or no, whatever you think the answer is. So we'll start with a very simple one, which of course everyone knows. All birds have two eyes. Yes or no? Just don't type in the chat box. Just click on yes or no.
So we have some 32 yeses, 33, 35.
Okay. Yes. So everyone agrees that all birds have two eyes. Excellent. So let's move on. The next statement, birds see the world in black and white. Birds see the world in black and white. Yes or no?
We have one yes, two yeses, three yeses, and 33 no's. Wait, it's fluctuating.
Okay.
Okay, so I think we'll go with this. Four yes and 36 no.
Okay.
And still increasing, but the ratio is going to be the same.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, next statement. Birds have excellent eyesight, much better than humans. Yes or no?
Forty yes and four no.
Okay. All right. So the next statement, and I'll reveal all the answers later. Okay. So next one. So listen to this carefully. Most birds have eyes on either side of their head, not facing forward like ours. So our eyes are facing forward. But so the statement says most birds have eyes on either side of their head, not facing forward like us. What do you think?
We have 34 yeses and seven no's.
Okay, let me write this down.
Okay, so that's actually 37 yeses. Yeah.
Okay.
36 or, yeah, and
no
six
problem.
No's. It's
So this is just for fun. It's not a competitive.
Yeah.
So, okay, so the next statement. Birds can rotate their eyes to see a 360-degree view. Birds can rotate their eyes to see a 360-degree view. What do you think? Yes or no?
Seven yes. And 34 no, 37 no.
Okay.
And 37, yeah.
Okay. So the last one. Many birds have eyelashes to protect the eye.
We have 12 yeses and 32 noes.
Okay. Okay. So that was some statements, and I won't reveal the answers yet. But what we'll do is we'll watch a video, and from the video you will get many of the answers to the statements that I read out. So this is the video that we're going to watch.
Birds have better eyesight than any other living creature. Although their eyes cannot move, they have other advantages that make up for this. This vulture, soaring high above the Michalisburg Range, can spot any dead or dying animal on the plain below. At the same time, it can see other vultures far out of range of our normal vision. And when one of them starts its spiraling descent to a source of food, others will follow immediately from several kilometers away. Falcons, looking for their prey from vantage points, have eyesight 8 times sharper than that of ourselves. We only see a small part of a bird's eye because the actual eyeball is extremely large and in most cases is actually larger than the brain. The eyeball of an ostrich, for example, is nearly as big as a tennis ball and is larger than any other land animal. Within the space, intricate focusing mechanisms come into play. Birds on the lookout for food, consisting of tiny insects or seeds, must be able to focus within less than a centimeter and at the same time keep an eye out for danger. This requires highly specialized focusing equipment, making it possible for them to focus from extreme close-up to infinity in a split second. This thrush, cocking its head, is not listening for a worm, as some people believe. It is, in fact, focusing its eye to detect the movement of its prey on the ground. Owls can see up to 100 times better than human beings at night. Experiments have shown that in complete darkness, they can locate their prey by their excellent hearing ability alone. Owls have their eyes positioned at the front of their face, just like us. This gives them a wider range of binocular vision, but they have to turn their heads if they want to see what's happening behind them. Because their eyes cannot move individually, birds often struggle to judge distance. This immature barn owl is moving its head from side to side in order to view its subject from different positions. By doing this, it gets a perception of distance. Shorebirds do this by bobbing their heads up and down to get different views of their subject in relation to the horizon. Eye owls, all our hunting eagles, have eyes positioned at the front of their face. The eyes of most other birds are situated on the side of the head, which means that they can cover a much wider field, enabling them to see almost everything around them.
Okay, so that video had a lot of information about birds and their eyesight. And so from the video, we got some of the answers to these questions. So birds have excellent eyesight. Birds see the world not in black and white, but actually in more colors than we do. Most birds have eyes on either side of their head, except for some birds which have forward-facing eyes like ours. And the video showed some of these birds, owls and birds of prey. Birds cannot move their eyes, actually. So from the video, we learned that birds' eyeballs are fixed and they cannot move them. Unlike us, where, you know, we can move our eyes if we have to see at the side, we can move our eyes, but birds cannot do that. And birds, actually many birds do have eyelashes. If you noticed in the ostrich, In the video, it had eyelashes. And some birds actually have very beautiful looking eyelashes. If you've seen a close-up of a photo of a hornbill, you would see really fine eyelashes. And these are hair, sort of like hair, but small bristles or feathers which have come up to protect the eye from sand and dust while the bird is flying. So how well do birds see? Most birds have very large eyes and very good eyesight. And we covered all this already. So birds can focus from very close to very large distances as well. And some birds which are nocturnal, which are active at night, can see extremely well in the dark, up to 100 times better than us in the dark. Another interesting feature that the video talked about was this binocular versus monocular vision. So what binocular vision means is that when you have two eyes, in case of humans, the eyes are set, are forward facing, but they're slightly different. So there's a large overlap and you get a view of the world where in a large part of the image, the two views overlap from your two eyes, and that's called binocular vision. Whereas if there's a portion that only one eye can see, that's called monocular vision. So if you notice, birds like pigeons have eyes on the side of their head. So each eye has a view like this, and there's a very small overlap at the front. But most of the region is the view seen by one eye. But as a result of this, pigeons and birds which have eyes on the side of their head have a very wide field of vision, almost 300 degrees. So it's better for them to look out for predators. If there's any danger, then they can get alerted very quickly because they can see almost 360 degrees around. Whereas owls and birds of prey have eyes that are forward facing like us. So just like we cannot see what's happening behind us, owls cannot see that as well. But owls have a unique feature that they can turn their head almost fully. So they can turn their head completely while sitting in the same place to see what's happening behind. But the advantage of having eyes that are forward facing means that they have better ability to figure out distance of a prey or the depth. So this helps when they are hunting for food. So that's a feature that is of advantage to them. So another very cool fact about the eyesight of birds is that birds can see ultraviolet light. When we discussed whether birds can see in black and white, actually birds can see all the colors that we can, and they can see actually more colors than us, and the colors look brighter. So what this means is that two birds that look very similar to us, to humans, may actually look very different from each other to a bird, because there are colors that birds can see which we cannot. Now, this is an interesting adaptation, and I want to pose a question to all of you. Can you think of some uses? Why would birds need this? Why would they need to see ultraviolet light? And what are the uses? What is the use of seeing in ultraviolet? Any responses, just type in the chat box, please.
Trishala says courtship. Vikram says to find food.
So, Misha, I've got the chat window open. Is it obstructing the screen?
No.
No. Okay.
It's super. Not.
Yeah. Super. So, yeah, lots of good responses. So, some uses of, being able to see in ultraviolet is that, as I mentioned, birds that look similar to us actually look different to birds. So, in many species, to us, the male and the female birds look the same. So we can't tell whether a bird is male or female, but the birds can tell because, you know, they can see additional colors. Then another use is that sometimes the food that the birds eat, birds which eat insects. So some insects, their shell reflects ultraviolet light. So it's easier then to see the prey for the bird if they can see in ultraviolet. Similarly, many fruits, berries as well, reflect ultraviolet light, whereas leaves do not. So then the contrast between the berry and the leaves of the trees is much more. And so it's easier for the birds to see those. So in courtship and in finding food, there are many uses of being able to see ultraviolet light. And this link here has a lot of information that's quite useful that you can look up later. So let's move on to another aspect. Can birds smell? So do birds have a strong sense of smell? What do you think? Any guesses?
Maybe we can use the poll again.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's possible. Yeah, everyone's typing.
Instead of typing in the chat box, maybe you can click the yes or no button.
Right, yeah. So just click yes or no. We'll see. So I think many people don't want to guess for this one because they may not know the answer. So that's okay. So about roughly 50-50 divided here, right? So
no, sorry. 33-66. I mean, more people think they don't have it. They don't have a strong sense of, It's 10 and 20, 11 and 19 actually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know where you saw 33.
No, I was talking about percentages, sorry.
Okay. Okay, so yeah, so I think, not a strong consensus either way. So actually, for a long time, ornithologists also thought that birds have a very poor sense of smell. And some very famous ornithologists, people who study and research birds, actually conducted experiments where they conducted some experiments and decided that birds don't have a strong sense of smell. But it turns out that the experiments were not very accurate or not well designed, because it's very hard for us to know whether birds can smell or not. How do we know? We can't ask them. So you have to design experiments and then try and figure out the answer based on what happens in the experiment. So for a long time, ornithologists thought that birds don't really have a good sense of smell. But only in the last 100 years, there's been more research and more careful experiments. And scientists have come to the conclusion that many birds actually have an excellent sense of smell. The sense of smell varies very widely between species in birds, but there are some birds which have a very good sense of smell. And any ideas on which bird you think might have an excellent sense of smell? Type in the chat box if you have an answer. Scavengers. Yeah, that's right. That's right, kites, vultures. So vultures have a very good sense of smell because it helps them to locate food. And, you know, one of the participants mentioned that she's been to Kenya. And Kenya, of course, and some places in India, like this photo is from Rajasthan, where you can see a lot of different varieties of vultures. And they all congregate on dead carcasses. So in the vast desert, to be able to locate the carcass, they have to have a strong sense of smell. And of course, they rely on eyesight as well. But smell plays a big role in that. So another question, how well can birds hear? And this one, first I'll ask another simpler question. Do birds have ears? What do you think? Do birds have ears?
Guys, again, you can use the yes and no buttons.
Yes. So yeah, I think everyone agrees that birds do have ears, birds can hear. But these feathers on the owl, are these its ears? Yes or no? Are these the ears of the owl? These feathers that are sticking out? Okay, so I'll tell you the answer. These are not the ears, actually, of the owl. They are just some display feathers, and we aren't quite sure what the use of these feathers is, but they are not the ears. The ears of birds are located behind the eyes, and they are covered by feathers. So you can't really see the ears. And birds have excellent hearing, of course, and especially owls have very sensitive ears. Because they hunt at night when it's completely dark. And so they, of course, they have a good eyesight, but they can also hear the prey moving around. So they rely on their hearing to hunt as well. And of course, we know that birds sing and they make varied songs. They use sounds to communicate with each other. So certainly they have to be able to hear those sounds. So one cool fact that if you've been to a heronry or a place where lots of, you know, numbers, huge numbers of birds are nesting in a small area, have you ever wondered how do they identify which babies are theirs? You know, do they end up sometimes going to the wrong babies by mistake and feeding the wrong chicks? Actually, they can identify their babies by the sound that they make. And what we know is that chicks may actually learn to communicate and hear sounds even before they have hatched from the egg. So hearing is an integral part of the senses of a bird. Which leads us to another question, why do birds sing? We've all heard birds singing around us in our homes, especially in this time when, you know, traffic noise is not there. So birds sing for a number of reasons. They sing to attract mates, to attract a partner, also to announce their territory. They also call sometimes an alarm when they see a predator or to announce the presence of food to their friends. And each species of bird has its own song and its own call, which is unique to it. So I'll play one of these bird calls for you. And this is a bird that's a very beautiful songster, which is found in our Western Ghats in India. I'll just play its call for you. So that bird is called the Malabar Whistling Thrush, and the nickname of this bird is the Whistling Schoolboy, because in the forest you often don't see the bird, but you just hear the whistling, and it sounds like a child whistling in the forest. So some cool facts about sounds of birds. The loudest birds in the world. So there's a bird called the three-wattled bellbird, which is found in South America, which can be heard more than 1 kilometer away. And I'll play its call for you. It's very, very loud. So that was the call of this bird. And there are other birds also that have extremely loud calls. Now, a question might occur to us that birds that have such loud calls, don't they go deaf listening to the sound of their own call? And it turns out that birds possess a reflex that reduces the sound of their own voice. So when they open their mouth to call or to sing, the ears get closed and they are not able to hear themselves as loudly because they have these really loud calls. So there are some very cool online tutorials on bird songs, which I will just share with you. So this is one of them. This is from Cornell Labs. It's a tutorial on bird calls, and you can explore the different reasons why birds sing and different things about their song. And I'll play one of these for you. So you can explore the videos and you can read about the birds' sounds as well. Then there's another one which I won't go through, but I'll briefly show you about how birds sing. And this shows the anatomy. And you can explore. You can also slow this down. So you can explore these and learn about bird sounds. And you can also explore these posters on Indian birds that we've come up with. So I'll show one of these to you. So this is a poster on common birds around us. And in this poster, you can actually change the language as well. So if you want to explore in any other language, Bengali, Hindi, Kannada, Marathi, Tamil, or Telugu, you can do that. So let's look at Hindi. And let's click on any bird. So this is a quail, and you can play a call. So this is the female quail. And did you know that the male and female quails have different calls? So here's the song of the male. So this is the more familiar call that we know of the quail. So you can explore these. And let me go back to So you can explore these, and there's a small game that we have a few minutes. So we'll just play a quick game where you have to guess the behavior. So I'm going to play a video, and you have to guess what the behavior is. So there's no sound in the video. It's just the visual. So this is a hoopoe. And what do you think this bird is doing? Type in the chat box. Okay, let's see. Mud bathing, looking for insects. Yeah. So, it's so that was dust bathing, and many birds actually do that. Do you know why they do that? What's the reason? Why do they dust bathe? Cools their bodies, okay. Yes, yeah. It helps to remove insects from their bodies. Yeah, great. Okay, let's watch one more video, and you have to tell me what this bird is doing. Okay, let's see what people think. Looking for male, looking for place to build a home. Yeah, that's right. So probably trying to build a nest, digging, out a tree hole. So barbets nest in trees, and barbets also make holes in trees, just like woodpeckers. So it's probably starting to do that. Okay. So here are some interesting books that you can refer to learn more about.
Garima, can you remove the bar? It's blocking the title.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So here are some books that you can refer to, which talk about the different aspects of the ecology and the behavior of birds. So this one, Bird Sense, talks about the different aspects of what it's like to be a bird. Many of the things that we covered in our sessions. And then this one talks about bird behavior. This is actually a nice book for children. It has a lot of lot of photos and quite simple text, so easy to understand. This one is not for kids, unfortunately, these two, but are good reference books for older bird watchers. This one is good for children. Then there are also some other books for children that we found, some of which have come out recently. We don't know, we haven't come across or read these books, but we thought we'll just refer them to you and you can look them up and see if you're interested. This is a book of essays by M. Krishnan, which are again nice for older bird watchers. So all our sessions, earlier sessions, are up on YouTube. You can refer them, you can look them up and go through them. There are some very nice art activities in some of those sessions. We'll also have another art activity coming up soon, so stay tuned for that. Our next session is going to be this Sunday, and it's going to be on some very, very interesting aspects of bird song. So do tune in for that. That's going to be at 11 this Sunday. And the details will be posted on our social media pages. The links we'll share with you. So that's all we have for this session. If there are any questions, we can try to answer them. Can we have more videos? So there are lots of videos you can look up. Sunday's session will be also on Zoom and will be live on Facebook. Please follow our social media profiles. The details will be posted there with the links. Kritika wants to know, how can we tell precisely what the bird is doing? Yeah, it comes from watching birds. You know, if you try to watch them regularly, you can get a good idea. But still, many times you won't be able to figure out what the bird is doing. Like, you know, sometimes you might see some behavior that you're not able to understand. So then maybe you look it up or you ask a bird watcher, you know, what do you think that bird is doing? And it can be actually really fascinating to watch behavior of birds and not just, the names of birds. Because through behavior, you get to know a little bit about the character of the bird. You know, what is it like? What does it eat? Where does it live? Things like that. Okay, someone's asked a question. Owl and eagle both hunt for food. Small reptiles, rats, squirrels, their position in food chain is also on the top, but the location of eyes are on different positions. So most birds of prey also have forward-looking eyes, if you've noticed, just like owls. So they can, they have more of binocular vision than other birds. So it helps them to judge depth and distance. How to observe water birds and their feeding behavior? So you can visit a lake or a wetland near you, and once the lockdown is over, of course, find a spot to sit, carry your notebook and a pencil with you, and you can sketch birds. Refer to our earlier session, third one in the series, which has a very simple tutorial on sketching birds. So you can follow that. Any suggestions for books in Indian languages, Raman says. Raman, would you like to suggest some books in Indian languages, or with your help, maybe we can compile a list of books and make it available? Do birds cry? That's a very interesting question. Thank you for asking that. So we don't know. I mean, I don't think birds cry like humans do. But do birds feel sorrow? I think so, you know. And sometimes you'll observe that birds which are, you know, which live in groups, which are social, if one member or one bird gets injured or dies, then all the other birds gather around it and, you know, try to help it if it's injured, or, you know, if it's dead, sometimes they still gather around it. And they appear to be, you know, expressing sorrow. So I think birds do feel sorrow, but I'm not sure if they cry like humans. Maybe emotions like being aggressive. Yeah, birds do express a lot of emotions as well. Okay, so I think if there are no further questions, let's end this session. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. And don't forget to log in this Sunday and join us for our next session on birdsong. Thank you and stay safe. Bye.